You know what time it is? It's time to worship God. So welcome to Happy Hour at the world famous Salvation Saloon Water and Home Church. Get ready to be blessed. So sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride as we take you out of this crazy world and into a spirit-filled, life-changing gospel show service. Already in progress.
Yeah, how's that? Yeah. Welcome everybody to Salvation Saloon Water and Old Church, and we are so glad you're all here today, because we are going to have a fine time worshiping the Lord and having fun while we do it, because that's what we specialize in. And I think it's Christmas, and we should say a thing or two about that, huh?
Down to the manger, see the little stranger wrapped in swaddling clothes, the Prince of Peace. Wheels start turning, torches start burning, and the old wise men journey from the bring the people so much joy. Son of a carpenter, Mary carried the light. This must be Christmas, must be tonight. Shepherd on a hillside, over my flock I find. On a cold winter's night, a band of angels sing. In a dream I heard a voice saying, fear not, come rejoice. It's the end of the beginning, praise the newborn King. How a little baby boy to bring the people so joy, son of a carpenter, Mary carried the light. This must be Christmas, must be tonight. I saw it with my own eyes, written up in the skies. The wires, simple herdsmen such as I. Then it came to pass, he was born at last, right below the star that shines on high. Our little baby boy could bring the people so much joy. A carpenter, Mary carried the light. This must be Christmas, must be tonight. Son of a carpenter, Mary carried the light. This must be Christmas, must be tonight.
The same feeling, knowing that Christmas is not just a season. Christmas should be every single day when we can just present this baby Jesus to everybody. The reason why he came here, the reason, because he came here for us, yeah, to get salvation. So this season, let's just have that in mind. Sometimes we think that Christmas is just going and buy stuff, and we get so overwhelmed. Some people get even depressed. No, Jesus is born. Jesus is here. And this is what we need to proclaim. Thank goodness it's Christmas. It's going to be a Christmas for somebody, even through the media. Through this media, we're going to proclaim that Jesus is here for you. He came to this world to save you. And his love never fails.
Amen. Amen.
Separate, even if I ran away, 'cause your love never fails. No, I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day, and your love never fails. Stand the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. The water's deep, but I'm not alone here in these open seas, 'cause your love never fails. Chasm is far too wide, never thought I'd reach the other side, but your love never fails. Stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Joy comes in the morning, and when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me, and your love never fails.
here's one of my favorite songs. It is just the moment I heard it, it spoke to me. It spoke loud and clear, like, this is you. You better pay attention to this song. But song called Less Like Me. Oh, I have days I lose the fight, try my best, but just don't get it right. Where I talk the talk that I don't walk, the moments are right before my eyes. Somebody with a hurt that I could have held, somebody with a hand that I could have held. I just can't see past myself, Lord help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. I've been saved from who I used to be. But even at my best, I must confess, I still need help to see the way you see. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped, somebody with a hand that I could have helped. But I just can't get past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. I want to be the beggar on the street, learn to be your hands and feet. Really give what I receive, Lord, help me be. I want to put you first above all else. Love my neighbor as myself. In the moments no one sees, Lord, help me be. One, two, three.
A little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus,
a little less like me, a little more like living everything I preach,
a little more like Jesus,
a little less like me. A little less like me. Yeah.
All right. Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon. And for those of you who may be here for the very first time, we always start our services out by letting you guys know we are so glad you guys are here, and we truly believe God's going to bless you guys today. There is one thing we would ask of you, though, if you don't mind, and that is if you just find one of these little yellow cards that you see all over the place, you would. Throw your name in that, tell us where you're from, that'd be cool. But then if you don't mind, if you just hold on to this card till the end of the service, right down at the bottom of the comment section, tell us what you thought. We're always kind of curious. So if you do that, that would be great. But again, welcome to the Salvation Saloon. From here on out, you are our guest, so sit back and hang on to enjoy the ride. Everyone else knows we do have some other purposes for these cards, though, and that is if there happens to be a birthday or an anniversary or could be just about anything that you think we've got to know about, we can put it on this card 1 week in advance. But the main reason we have these cards is for prayer. So if you're here and you have a need in your life, put that need down on this card and give God an opportunity to show himself strong, because prayer does work. Amen? Well, this is what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us that our God is a present help in times of trouble, but also tells us that sometimes we have not because we ask not. So again, put your needs down on this card. All right, well, here at the Salvation Salute, we are a family, like every family. We try to make sure that we always recognize each other. And by God, I think we got a birthday, don't we, Rob? All right, happy birthday, Liana. And there's a game we play each and every week, and the name of that game is Name That Salutatic. Now, if you are here for the first time, just so you do know, we do call our congregation members Salutatics. And every week what we do is we usually try to get an old picture, throw it up, try to guess who it is. And I've got one for you. See what you can do with this. You can tell me who this Salutatic is. Yeah, that is not Dave George.
That's there.
Is that Bernadette?
Bernadette?
Oh.
Suzanne? Let's find out. Will the real Salutatic please stand up? And in the back, it's Christine Baker. Little Christine Baker right there. All right, got a couple things to pass on to you guys. One is today after the service, we are going to be doing a love ride. As I think most of you know, Carol Wallace, who is our greeter, she had a fall at the house, and she's all busted up. Anyway, she's in some rehab, and we're going to stop by today, and we're going to cheer her up. So any of you that can make it, you are all invited to go with us. The address is, it's by Morton Plant Hospital in Clearwater. So after we break down here, by the time we get over there, we'll probably meet up around 12 o'clock, I'm thinking. But the address is 400 Corbett Street in Clearwater. 400 Corbett Street in Clearwater. Colleen was over there, so she told me that if you're heading south on Fort Harrison, when you pass O'Keefe's Restaurant, that next light, you take a right there, and then it's going to be on the corner of, I guess, Harrison and Pinellas, down in there. Oh, Fort Harrison and Pinellas. That's Pinellas. Corbett Street must be down there. So take a right at there. So anyways, 400 Corbett Street. Put it on your phone, and we'll meet you there. Carol is such a faithful person. She's been with our church for such a long time, and she's got a little road to go to recover her health and get back here and do what she's been called to do. So it'd be great if we can to be able to do that after the service. Got any questions, check with Sue, and she can give you these addresses again. Next Saturday, the Salvation Salute is going to have a table at the Newport Richey Harley-Davidson. They're having an event there, and where I guess it's a Christmas fair. And we're going to have a table, and we're going to be selling some items. The ladies have been getting together. They've been putting a lot of stuff together, making a lot of items. And whatever they do sell is going to be going back to the church. So if you want to stop in next week, Newport Richey Harley-Davidson, we will be there. That's next Saturday between 11 and 3 p.m. And last but not least, Colleen's been calling around, and she is going to have a holiday party, kind of a after Christmas, New Year's party at her house. It's going to be actually the Sunday after Christmas, so it'll be after service, and it's going to be a potluck, and she's asking people to bring a re-gift, and I'll have more on that as in the next couple weeks. But if you want to just mark that on your calendar, we will be having a church party at Colleen's on that date. All right, I think that's it. So moving right along, continuing with our happy hour, I'm going to get Willie up here, and he is going to pray God's blessing on our service. So here is Willie.
Hello, everybody. I want to thank you all for being here. And if you brought someone with you today, you've been listening to me. And also, I always try to give a testimony when I'm up here, and I've got one I'd like to share with you. We were at an event, a church event, with our booth, and we always pray for everybody. I love praying for people. And I got all the children at this event to come together, and I prayed with them. And we were done, and one of the little boys, he's like 10 years old, came up to me, and he said, Mister, will you pray for my grandma? She has cancer, and I don't want, and I'm afraid I'm losing her. And his grandma was raising him. So definitely, I prayed with him there for his grandma. And then he goes, I want you to meet her. And he took me over to a place she was at. I met her, and it was pretty emotional, but it wasn't even 2 weeks later, we get a call from one of our friends who lives next near this grandma, and said that little boy's ran away. He's homeschooled by grandma, so he has no schoolmates. He has no family but grandma, and he had shorts on, a t-shirt, and his bike, and it was dark, and it was cold, and nobody knew where he was at. And they called the sheriff. The sheriff got a helicopter in the air. They were looking everywhere for this little boy, not knowing what direction he would go because he really had no one to go to. And they found him in a park sitting by himself. It must have been 2 hours later. But the point I'm trying to get across is I always say this, be ready. You never know when someone's going to come to you and say, I need prayer. This little boy needed it for his grandma. But if you touch their heart, I believe that they'll know that God is looking over them. He ran away. He was scared. He didn't know what was going to happen in his future. But when he got over there, he was sitting by himself, and I'd like to think he was praying to God because he needed him. At that point in his life, he needed him. But if he had not come to me and asked me to pray for his grandma, I would have not known any of this. So please, please, please be ready to pray. You never know when it's going to come to you. At this time, I'd like to do an offering prayer. And I ask that you give your offering to help the church here, but don't break the bank. Give what you can. We don't expect everybody to give a million-dollar check, but empty your pennies out of your pocket.
Oh, wait, just a minute.
Yeah. If you want to.
Yeah, if it moves you.
If you're in the mood to, that's right. Can we please bow our heads, remove our hats? Lord, we want to thank you for bringing us all together here today. You give us a new day, and every day we wake up, we know it's from you. We love waking up in your wonderful world. We know there's turmoil, and we know that you're going to handle that turmoil in this country and other countries that are suffering. Lord, we thank you as you can hear the little ones in the background. You gave us those little angels to families that you know will raise them in a Christian manner. And those kids will grow up in a Christian life. And they'll pass that on, Lord, to others and just continue the love for you. Lord, we ask that you look over the sick that we have in our congregation and also within our families and our friends and our neighbors. Look after their welfare, Lord, so that they're protected and they know that they have you looking over them and your hands touching them so they know you're there to be with them and guide them and comfort them. All this we say in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And in light of that story about praying for somebody, here's a good song to go along with that.
Everybody's got a story to tell. Everybody's got a wound to be healed. I wanna believe there's beauty here. 'Cause oh, I get so tired of holding on. I can't let go. I want to believe there's meaning here. How many times have you heard me cry out, God, please take this? How many times have you given me strength to just keep breathing? Oh, I need you.
All right, thank you, Nitty Gritty Church Band. Okay, so today we'll be studying chapter 20 of Luke's Gospel. We got 47 verses today. We're going through them all. But to set things up, it was last time that Jesus made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem, fulfilling prophecy as he humbly entered on a donkey while receiving the messianic praises of the 118th Psalm. And those praises signified that this was the day that the Lord had made, a day to rejoice and be glad, because this was the day that God had ordained to bring the kingdom of God to man, which fulfilled a promise. Actually fulfilled a promise that was given to Abraham way back in the Old Testament, way back in the book of Genesis, and it was a promise of a new and better covenant that would provide salvation, no longer through the sacrifices made by man, but by a sacrifice made by God, as Jesus entered Jerusalem to offer himself as the Lamb of God who had come to take away the sins of the world. So as we come to Luke chapter 20, we are now in the final week of the life of Jesus. And so after cleansing the temple last week, he arrived into Jerusalem, cleansed the temple, right? He drove out the money changers, the dove merchants, those who had turned God's house into a den of thieves. And then it told us that Jesus then began to focus his time to teaching in the temple, while the religious leaders, well, they were focusing their time by plotting a way to kill him. And that will bring us now to chapter 20 and to verse 1, which says this. It says, one day Jesus was teaching the people in the temple courts, and he was proclaiming the good news. Now again, this is the last week of the life and ministry of Jesus. So this is like his last chance to promote the purpose of his mission. And it's a mission that no one, including his own disciples, have been able to really understand and comprehend. So he needs to provide the answers to the questions that his death is about to create. And so this time in the temple here is very important. But as he's teaching, it tells us that the chief priests and the teachers of the law, together with the elders, they came up to him. And in verse 2, well, they had a question for Jesus. They ask him, they say, tell us by what authority you are doing these things. And by things, they're talking about all the crazy miracles that Jesus had performed. And then they also asked him, who gave you this authority? Who gave you this power? Now, the answer to this should be obvious, right? Because the things that Jesus was doing was things that only God could do, right? And plus, Jesus had publicized his relationship with God on numerous occasions. So, I mean, there was really no mystery as to how he would answer. But here's the thing here. That was exactly why they were asking this. Because now what they want to do is they want to use it against him by accusing him of committing blasphemy. But of course, Jesus knew what they were up to. And so in verse 3, tells us that he replied by saying, I will ask you a question. So it's kind of like, you answer me and then I'll answer you. And he says this, tell me this in verse 4. John's baptism, was it from heaven or of human origin? So he asks it basically the very same question, but he's asking of John, right? So it's, whose authority did John operate under? And in verse 5, well, they kind of all get in a little huddle here, kind of like the Family Feud, and it says that they started discussing this among themselves. That's what they were saying. They said, if we say from heaven, that John came from heaven, well, he will ask, well, why didn't you believe him? Right? They say that because John proclaimed that Jesus was the Messiah, right? They proclaimed that Jesus was the Son of God. And in verse 6, their other option would be this, but if we say of human origin, then all the people will stone us because they are persuaded that John was a prophet. So here they are, right? Here they were. They're trying to trap Jesus with a question. But look what Jesus does, right? He just kind of turns the tables on them. And since any way they actually respond is going to create a problem for them, then in verse 7 says they answered, we do not know where he was from. Now, you'd think they'd learn, because every time that they've tried to outsmart Jesus, Jesus always outsmarted them. And sure enough, we see that again as, you know, once again, they're publicly humiliated. Anyways, they have no answer for Jesus. And so in verse 8, Jesus has no answer for them as he says this. He says, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. But he does have something important to share. And so as it now says in verse 9, well, he went on to tell the people a parable. Went on to tell them this parable. And this is what he says. He says, a man planted a vineyard, and he rented it to some farmers and went away for a long time. Now, kind of hate to kick a man when he's down, but this story is going to ring a bell for these religious leaders here, right? Because there's actually a similar story in Isaiah chapter 5, and there the vineyard is said to be that the nation of Israel. So as he's telling this parable, they're going to know that he is talking about them. Anyways, as the parable now continues in verse 10, it says, at harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants so that they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And then in verse 11, he sent another servant, but that one also they beat and treated shamefully and sent him away empty-handed. Now, to spiritually describe what's going on here, the owner of the vineyard here, this is God, right? This represents God, right? And the servants that he is sending, well, that would represent God's prophets that God had sent to the nation of Israel in the Old Testament, right? And as we know, those prophets were often rejected and killed. In Luke chapter 13, maybe you remember, but we saw Jesus refer to this when he said there a couple chapters back, he said, oh, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you. But as the story continues in verse 12, well, it now says this. It says that he then sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out as well. So in verse 13, then the owner of the vineyard, he says this. You know, he starts talking to himself, and he says, well, what shall I do? And he says, I will send my son. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they'll respect him. I think it's obvious who the son is representing here, right? It's representing Jesus. Who, in verse 14, when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. This is the heir. This is the heir, they say. Let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. So in verse 15, they threw him out of the vineyard, and they killed him. Now, this is a prophetic parable, right? Because this is exactly what these guys are about to do to God's son, right? To Jesus. Now, what's interesting is that despite killing their own prophets, the Jews, well, they then erected all these tombs to honor those prophets. And because unlike their fathers, well, they said that, you know, well, we never, you know, would have done what they did. But to that statement in Matthew chapter 23, well, Jesus said this. He said, you testify against yourself. You're testifying against yourself. And why did he say that? Well, saying that because here they are saying that they would never have killed their prophets, and yet even worse, they're about to kill their Messiah. They're about to kill their Messiah. Anyways, returning to the parable, it's Jesus who asks, what then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? And in verse 16, he answers by saying, he will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. But when the people heard this, they said, God forbid, God forbid. Well, they say God forbid because they knew that he was talking about them. Right? So it's like, you know, you're wrong, Jesus. You're wrong because, you know what, we're God's people. He would never forsake us. Right? He would never forsake us. And they're right. You know, they're actually right. Here's the part they're missing, right? And that is, as the parable states, they're the ones that forsook their God. They forsook their God when they rejected his son. But here they are, they're saying, God forbid. And to that in verse 17, Jesus looks directly at them and he asks, "Then what is the meaning of that which is written? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." Now, that's a statement, okay, that also comes from that 118th Psalm, you know, which, again, is that same Messianic Psalm that spoke of the praises that the coming Messiah would receive, which we saw fulfilled last week in chapter 19, right, when Jesus entered Jerusalem. So coming from that prophetic Messianic Psalm, that stone that was rejected, that's referring to Jesus, right? That stone is Jesus. And that is, if you want to go look at Acts chapter 4, actually Acts 4:11, you'll see that confirmed. Peter confirms that there. So what that means that stone is saying that Jesus is the foundation. He is the rock of our salvation. Jesus is the rock of our salvation. And in verse 18, about that rock, well, it's Jesus who then says this. He says, "Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces. But anyone on whom it falls will be crushed." All right, there are two relationships that we can have with Jesus, right? One is to accept him by falling before him in submission, and the other is to reject him and be crushed, right? So we can choose to fall on the love of God and be broken of our pride and our self-will, or we can be crushed by the judgment of our very own choice to reject him. But in response to what Jesus said here, at verse 19, it tells us that the teachers of the law and the chief priests, they now look for a way to arrest him immediately because they knew he had spoken this parable against them. But again, it tells us they were afraid of the people. They were afraid of the people. All right. They're at the point now, they've pretty much taken all that they're going to take from this Jesus guy. But they also know that to get rid of him, they're going to need to turn all his support against him. And so in verse 20, it says, keeping a close watch on him, well, they sent in some spies, right? So we now have got some, we got the undercover Jewish vice squad has moved in, infiltrated Jesus, and they're in there, and it says that they pretended to be sincere and hope to catch Jesus in something he said so that they might hand him over to the power and authority of the governor. All right, so we got some spies. We got some Jewish spies, and they're trying to find, you know, something incriminating so that they can then turn Jesus over to the Roman government. So now, with their plan in place, verse 21 tells us that the spies question him. They infiltrate. They now question Jesus, and they ask him this. They say, "Teacher, we know that you speak and teach what is right, and that you do not show partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth." All right, so they're just laying it on thick and heavy here, and now that they've got they've set the hook. Well, now they ask in verse 22. Ask this in verse 22. They say, "Is it right for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" Now, ever since 6 A.D. the Jews were forced to pay taxes to Rome. But being God's people, right, they despised being in subjection to anyone but God. I mean, they truly hated being under that Roman rule, right? But here's where the trap lies. Because if Jesus says the tax should be paid, then he'll be denying that sovereignty of God to rule over them, over Israel. And that would possibly help sway the Jewish support that he has and help cause him to turn against him. But if he says it shouldn't be paid, that would make him an enemy of Rome, right? And you know what they would be doing. They'd be, religious leaders would then be going to Rome and saying, well, here's this Jesus guy. He's out there, you know, inciting a revolt. So they really think that they have him, right? This is kind of a no-win situation here. But in verse 23, tells us that He saw through their duplicity, right? Jesus, he recognized their deceptive plan. And he said to them in verse 24, says, hey, show me a denarius. You know, give me that coin, right? Denarius is a coin. He says, show me that coin. And then Jesus asks, whose image and inscription is on that coin? And they reply, Caesar's. And so in verse 25, he said to them, then give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God's. So the coin, right, give the coin to who it belongs to, but give your life to the God that it belongs to. All right, well, what did Jesus just do? He just took this no-win question, and he answered it to the appeasement of both Jew and Roman alike. Right? He appeased both the Jews and the Romans. So once again, as it says in verse 26, they were unable to trap him in what he had said there in public. And it says, astonished by his answer, they became silent. But now in verse 27, we see that some of the Sadducees, now this is another religious group among the Jews. And here's the thing with the Sadducees. They say there is no resurrection. And they come to Jesus. They also have a question. Now, these Sadducees, what their deal was, they were basically kind of like the rationalists of their day, right? And they did not believe in the resurrection. They didn't believe in the afterlife. But what they did is they lived in accordance to the first five books of the Bible, okay, which is known as the Torah, so the five books of Moses. And actually, in those five books, there is not much that is said about the post-death experience. Anyways, in verse 28, so they asked Jesus, they go, teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife but no children, the man must marry the widow and raise up offspring for his brother. Now, basically, that law was for this purpose, right? And that was to keep the family tree alive in the nation of Israel. So if a man married a woman, but he died before he had children, well, it was his brother's responsibility at that time to then marry her, and then the firstborn would be named for him, for the brother that passed away, and that way his name would not die in Israel. Now, these dudes could have just stopped there, these Sadducees, right? But no, they just keep going. They're going to turn this into this, well, they turn this into this really stupid hypothetical question. Here it is. This is good. Verse 29 says, now there were seven brothers. The first one married a woman and died childless. And in verse 30, likewise, the second. And in verse 31, then the third married her. And in the same way, the seven died. All seven died, leaving no children. And then in verse 32, finally, the woman died too. And now in verse 33, well, here's the question. And that is, at the resurrection, whose wife will she be since the seven were married to her? All right. Here they are, right? They're asking this really stupid question. And the reason it's really a stupid question, again, is because they're Sadducees, right? Because they don't even believe in the resurrection. So all they're doing here is they're just trying to make the resurrection look foolish, right? Just look foolish. And so they create all this drama and turmoil in heaven. I guess kind of like these brothers are going to be up there, you know, fighting each other over this one woman, right? But here's where they messed up. And that is they're perceiving life in heaven as if it's going to be the same as life on earth. But Jesus is now going to set them straight. When in verse 34, he says this, he says, the people of this age marry and are given in marriage. But in verse 35, those who are considered worthy of taking part in the age to come and in the resurrection of the dead, well, they will neither marry nor be given in marriage. Now, obviously, there's a whole lot of stuff that we don't know about heaven, right? And Scripture does tell us a few things, though. It tells us that we will recognize each other in heaven. And so what that means is that, you know, when we get to heaven, there is going to be a great reunion. Amen? Going to be a great reunion. And to think about how cool that is going to be, to be able to see all our saved loved ones, right, who died before us, right, like our grandparents and our parents and, you know, our relatives and our friends. And then think about this. Just think about how cool it will be to meet all the biblical heroes, you know, the guys that we read about, you know, here every week. So, I mean, it's going to be incredible, right? Heaven's going to be like heaven. Amen? But as Jesus tells us here, a husband and wife in this life, although they'll recognize each other, they'll no doubt still have a special bond, but their relationship is going to be different than it was on the earth. And in verse 36, Jesus also explains this about the people in heaven. He says, also tells us that they can no longer die. Well, that's a bonus, amen? That's a good deal. The reason they can't die is because they're going to be like the angels, or they're going to be spiritual beings, right? They're God's children, right? And they're God's children since they are children of the resurrection. So what we've seen here is Jesus obviously acknowledges the resurrection. But to these Sadducees, right, if they cannot find the resurrection in the books of Moses, then this description by Jesus, I mean, it may seem to them, I mean, just as ridiculous as that question that they just asked Jesus. But if life after death can be found in the book of Moses, well, I'm thinking it would be Jesus who could do it. Amen? And so now in verse 37, sure enough, Jesus is now going to point something out that they apparently missed. And so he directs them to Exodus chapter 3, and he says this. He says, but in the account of the burning bush, we remember that, we know that story. It says, even Moses showed that the dead rise. For he calls the Lord the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. And so it's in verse 38 that Jesus makes this conclusion, and that would be that he is not the God of the dead. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living, for to him all those guys are alive, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, at the time Moses stood before the burning bush, Jacob had been dead for 400 years. All right, Isaac and Abraham, even longer, right? But in the text of their Torah, Moses wrote that God said he is their God. Now, God would not say that he is their God speaking in the present tense if they no longer existed. Right? I mean, instead, he would have just said, well, you know, they were once, he once was their God, right? Now, that's something that a person could read over and over, you know, 100 times and still kind of miss that. But Jesus pulls this out, and I think by doing that, he proves that he truly knows the scriptures. And anyways, that was such a good find, and I think this is pretty cool, because now in verse 39, it tells us that even some of the teachers of the law responded by saying, well said, teacher. Well said, teacher. So that one actually got Jesus a couple enemies rooting for him, right? Now in verse 40, after kind of handling everything that they could throw at him, well, it now tells us this, tells us that no one dared to ask him any more questions, right? They've given up. They can't outsmart Jesus. So now verse 41, well, I guess Jesus figuring it's his turn, because it's then that Jesus says this to them. He says, why is it said that the Messiah is the son of David? Okay, prophecy said this. Prophecy said that the Messiah would come from the seed of David, right? And so the Jews took that to believe that the Messiah would then be, if he's going to be a son of David, then he would just be some man, right? He'd be some future prophet. So they were not looking for some God-man, which is why they were always playing that blasphemy card, right, against Jesus. But in verse 42, Jesus points this out when he says, David himself declares in the book of Psalms, right? David said this. He said, the Lord said to my Lord, right? So the Lord, speaking of God the Father, who's speaking to my Lord, which would be David's Lord, which would be the Messiah, and it's God who says to the Messiah then, sit at my right hand until in verse 43, I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. And now the question that Jesus has for them is this in verse 44. Jesus now says, if David calls him Lord, how then can he be his son? Right? If Jesus is calling the Messiah Lord, how can he be his son? All right? Or how can the Messiah be just a man? All right, here's the point. Back then, and we know this, but they existed in this patriarchal society, right, where the father always ruled, right? There was no exceptions. The father's father always ruled. So no father would ever call his son Lord. And so here, Jesus has just shed some light to these guys, shed some light on their perception of who the Messiah was going to be, right? And so right now, if they were willing to be honest with themselves, they just might have to submit to the fact that a regular old man or prophet would not and could not fill the shoes of the Messiah. So here we go. I believe Jesus, he's dealt with these guys. They've asked him questions. He's asked them a few questions. And I think Jesus had a pretty good day defending himself, you think? I think he did pretty good. But as for these guys, after being humiliated again, I'm thinking these Jewish leaders are now more determined to ever to find a way to kill Jesus. And Jesus is going to help them out. He's going to fuel the fire some more in these last couple verses. When he says this, verse 45, it says, while all the people were listening, Jesus said this to his disciples. And that is in verse 46, right? Everyone's listening. He says, beware of the teachers of the law, right? These guys are right there. Beware of the teachers of the law. He says, they like to walk around in flowing robes and love to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and have the most important seats in the synagogue and the places of honor at banquets. Well, as Jesus had stated before, these guys sought the praises of men over the praises of God. And although they put on a good show, right, walked around in flowing robes, right, although they put on a good show, Jesus also said that they honored God with their lips, but their hearts were far, far from him. And as the chapter now concludes in verse 47, well, Jesus now adds this as well. He says, they also devour widows' houses, right? Because their concern for self, it was much stronger than their pity and much stronger than their compassion. And then he says, for a show, they also make lengthy prayers, right? Everything was a big show. And the results of their self-serving faith, well, Jesus says this. He now concludes this. He said, these men will be punished most severely. They'll be punished most severely. Why will they be punished most severely? Because they're phonies, right? And what makes it even worse is they're religious phonies, right? And God takes offense to anyone who falsely represents him. And so it is not self-promotion that God is looking for, right? Because just as Jesus had said earlier, Jesus said, those who exalt themselves in this life, they will be humbled. But those who humble themselves, they will be exalted. And that concludes chapter 20, which means this, right? It means that if this is chapter 20, that means next week is chapter 21, and it's in chapter 21 that Jesus will provide his disciples with a sign of the times. Sign of the times. What are we talking about? We're talking about the end times. We're talking about the last days. So you may want to be here for that. I mean, that's always a pretty interesting topic. And I'm thinking, as time goes on, I'm thinking that that's a topic that's getting more interesting with each passing day, right? Because prophecy is happening, people, right? It is being fulfilled. And what that means is, that means that each day, man, we are one day closer to Christ's return and our redemption. Amen? All right. So that's the lesson for today. And here's Jason to close. Love you guys.
Good morning, y'all. That's some good stuff. It's good stuff because we know where we're going. We're heading to the cross. And in Jesus' day, the cross was an ugly thing. It was torture. It was a slow, painful death designed exclusively to cause fear. It's not that anymore. It's a sign of victory, love, sacrifice. We put it on our wall. My wife wears it on her necklace. It's a beautiful thing now. Let's just recognize what happens when you add a little Jesus to something. It's no longer ugly. Let's go to the throne room and talk to the King. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity for us to get together. Thank you for all these people that are willing to come here and to worship you together. May we continue to grow and continue to keep our focus right where it needs to be, on you and on the cross and what you did there. Amen. Thanks, guys. If you can help clean up, that'd be fantastic.